developers in control. I'm Patrick van Dissel from Boltcomps, and I will take you on the journey from my team, BPI, the build automation team, build tools automation team from 2012 somewhere till now, and where we're going towards in 2018. I have four demos, and sadly they are not live demos because they took too long to do that live. So they are recorded, but hopefully still interesting. And we're going bit by bit, so there might be some year changes between 2012 and now. If it's not clear where it is, then just ask. Yeah, so DPI. DPI is the Development Process Innovation Team, aka the Build Tools Automation Team. We create, manage, integrate build tools to innovate on the development process. And we do that since 2012. We're about 6 engineers, and we're fully autonomous, which means besides the VMs and the hardware, everything that's on top of there, we do it ourselves. So we're like developers and ops in one. Even our product owner and Scrum Master, which is one guy, is in our team and he's doing the performance test stuff. So we're doing everything ourselves. And so the TAXP, the test acceptance, XPR, still don't know what XPR stands for. Maybe you know, production. So the DTOP. Street. So before 2012, as far as I understood, because I wasn't here yet, before 2012 everything was released manually. So someone compiled the application locally, created the WAR application, and put it on an FTP somewhere, and then someone else FTP'd it to the production environment. And in 2012, we started automating that. We started doing that with Jenkins. Like most of you probably. And in the beginning, it was just like create a job, click through all the settings, press save, and cross your fingers that it works. And if someone else came in, you do the same thing again. So when I came in here in this team in 2014, there were 6 guys clicking through Jenkins because we had about 700 jobs in there. And they're full-time clicking through Jenkins, so there was no improvement, no innovation on the continuous delivery or the development process in general. So the first thing that we did was what I did when I came in the team was make sure Jenkins is completely automated. Just push to Git and all the Jenkins jobs are in there. So how does that work? I can give you a demo for. I will give you a demo on that. So I'm not going in depth on how it actually works. I will link to a presentation that does that because that takes another hour. So if we want to fill the second slot, we can do that. But it will just show how quickly it works and how hard it works. So we have a Jenkins script. Which starts a Docker container. And in the Docker container, it's pre-configured with all plugins. And we're creating a C job. And the C job is the only job that's here. It's created by putting in XML. But in our Jenkins setup, it's the only job that's created manually. And the only thing that's in there is listen to this Git repository and every change that happens there. Moses, the Jenkins job data as it's like the old school Jenkins pipelines, for those who are familiar with it. And that's it. And from that configuration, it will generate all the jobs. So in a few seconds, it will show you the console output. But basically, it's a Gradle project with Groovy scripts in there, a bunch of JSON files that are configured by the users. They make changes on that by doing merge requests. And our team, as DPI, we accept those merge requests or deny them. And when accepted, it's applied to Jenkins. And this is the first time that it has run, so it will download all the dependencies. But basically, it's a Jenkins upgraded project in Groovy, running unit tests and everything that's needed on a normal core project. Yeah, there's some refreshing issue in this Jenkins version, so I have to press F5 all the time. But in the end, we will see a lot of jobs in here.
This is how it runs now, or how you did it 3 years ago?
This is how we did it in 2014, and it's still running. It's just quite a bit large. A little bit large. So, it's done.
Will you share this presentation by
now? Yeah, everything will be shared, the video will be shared. And I can tell you that the presentation that I did in 2014 about how this works has all the demos in there. So everything is, you can just download the code and run it yourself. So in this, the CJOP here runs for about 1.5 minutes, and it generated for 700 jobs, something? Yeah, so 747 jobs. That's a lot of clicking if you have to do it manually. So, so in the background it was enable save HTML so we can have a nice description for the jobs. But it saves us a lot of time. So we went from 6 guys managing Jenkins jobs to 5 guys who actually could improve something, and 1 guy who's on a rotating engineer on duty shift, which is like the incident guy or support guy. So all the requests for support go to 1 guy in our team, and that rotates every sprint. So that makes, that frees up a lot of time. So all the Jenkins jobs, so they have descriptions saying, telling you about who's the owner of this application, what kind of application is it, when is it deployed, if there's a scheduled deploy, or
So Patrick, the data is put in the JSON file by the development team.
Yep, by the users themselves. So we just have a template and the rest of the users just copy.
You fill it in and then we generate the stuff.
Yeah. So we created, with the Jenkins update, we created a little framework around a JSON file. And a JSON file that describes pipelines for your applications, your databases, whatever. Yeah, whatever type you support. So, and from that we generate views. So we have different kind of views on the Jenkins jobs from your team side or from your application side. Yeah, and it works. Users are happy and they know how to find the application jobs.
So if a new job is added in the specification, do you regenerate the whole Jenkins or do you just incrementally only have that one job?
We just say, here's the new repository, do whatever you need to do, job DSL.
Yeah.
And the job DSL keeps a history of what jobs did it generate the last time. And so, also if you remove a configuration, it will automatically be removed from Jenkins.
Yeah. And if Jenkins is updated, do you spin up a new, completely new one? Or?
No. I will come on that.
Yeah, because I was wondering, it's not just the jobs, but also the history of all builds that people are interested in.
So the history is just one end of this year.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. I will comment on that later.
But this is still
this is still running.
So this is building the whole full
yeah.
application, everything which is
okay. The whole Jenkins setup, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. In our current setup there's one job that's manually configured, that's the C job, the rest is generated.
Okay.
So you have the C job kicking off a Gradle build. Kicking off the job GSL.
Yeah.
And how many times do you run the C job? Is it like for disaster recovery or is it daily?
For every push.
Oh.
So whenever a user has a merge request and we accept it, it's running.
Okay.
And that means that this job, if all the dependencies are cast, it runs in about 30 seconds. But our actual C job runs for 5 to 10 minutes. Because I don't know if you know how Jenkins works internally, but it's one big singleton with a lot of locking, and it needs to get all the locks through all the locks. So it takes about 10 minutes most of the time. Yeah. So we went from manual edits to kind of scripting stuff, where to do templates, to the Jenkins job DSL, and the last one, the Gradle Jenkins plugin. We didn't use that, but this is coming from some Jenkins. Just curious, who's still at this manual editing stage? Don't be scared. 2, 3, count 5, 6 people, okay? And just for your indication, for my indication, how big is your Jenkins instance? Are you managing only the jobs for your own team or for the whole company? Anyone?
Only
team.
Okay. We're a mix. So people's job, people still create manual jobs. Use a Python code.
Okay. And that's for the whole company or for the only one team?
Also for own team, and we have standard pipelines. Together it's something like 15,000.
Okay. More than we have. Yeah, it's a nice amount. And anyone scripting his Jenkins jobs? Yeah?
No,
not scripting, section.
No?
Job days are there? Or pipeline? Okay. Also about 5, 6. And is that also for the team only or for
five
the whole
teams?
Company? Sorry?
5 teams.
5 teams. Okay. Yeah, so DPI, we manage the whole build tools for the whole company. Not for each team, but for the whole company. We just to make that clear.
Is that a good practice? Because that's so one team managing that for the whole company. Do you think that's
in my viewpoint? Yes. For some companies, no. It purely depends on how big is your company. How, for example, Let me come back to on that later on. Yeah.
Okay. Are you using the external solutions?
No,
okay.
We are not using it. Because that means that you have a... it's kind of the same as Jenkins job DSL, only instead of using the Jenkins job DSL plugin, which directly works inside Jenkins, you push your Jenkins jobs configurations via the API of Jenkins.
Yeah.
So it has no clue about if it... or at least, as far as I have seen, is that it has no clue about if a job was already there or that you removed it. So the job DSL was more valuable for us. Yes. So with this, we deliver self-service to the users within a limited framework. As DPI, we define what the framework is and what type of pipelines are available and what different maturity levels are there. The teams can still create a pull request for their configuration, or they can create pull requests to add features, and we're happy to review that. But basically, we as DPI define this is what we provide. So we have different type of pipelines for app, the database, APIs, documentation, and some other types.
What do you mean with maturity levels?
Yeah. Next slide. So we have maturity levels, which is man on the moon. So we call it Man on the Moon. It was an initiative started by I don't know, management or so. they were educating the teams to do smaller releases, basically, and take more responsibility on their builds and their applications. So they started Man on the Moon, and there were three phases in there. there was Man on the Moon phase one, where every code push was a deployment to test, and they could do prediction fixes on a specific branch, which is called sculpt, backslash slash, and then the name of your branch. And you had to ask when you had the deployment artifact ready, you had to ask SRT, like the ops guys, for hey, I want to deploy this, can you do this for me? Or are you agreeing that I deploy this? So that was phase one. So it's like taking the developers by the hand, please do this step, and then go to production. And when your team was enjoying this and learned enough to go to the next stage phase? No. Yes. Then you can do the same, but then deploy yourself. So it's purely an organizational change. There's no change in the Jenkins pipelines. But it was just phase two is you can do your deployments yourself. You decide when you deploy. What is that? So we have phase three, which is basically mastering production. And you are on your own. It's your job. Do whatever you want to do. So from the Jenkins side and the pipelines in Jenkins, this was a good way forward. So to give you an idea, some company information and their Jenkins club. So we have in 2014 we started automating Jenkins. And then we had about 100 developers, and from that we had about 700 Jenkins jobs. And so those are mostly, and in the beginning of the year they were manually configured, and in the end of the year they were automated. But still we had manually configured jobs somewhere. I think there were 300 or so. And at the end, in the starting of 2015, we got rid of all the manual configured jobs. And now we are at about 5,300. So it's not 15,000, but it's a nice amount. And to keep this running, hi, the clear noise. It's a big deal. So to keep this running, we run one master with 47 gigabytes of RAM, and the GVM is about 20 gigabytes, and the rest is caching. And to run all the to keep all the builds, build configurations and build artifacts, we need 800 gigabytes of disk, and we have 8 build slaves, one build slave. Most of them are VMs, but there's one build slave we have in bare metal. We have that for the web shop, because if you run the web shop build on a VM, it takes about an hour. If you run it on the same build on a bare metal, it takes 20 minutes. So that saves a lot for our production releases. And yes, we have about 160,000 Jenkins slaves. This is basically a very small desktop VM and running Selenium tests.
What kind of build systems do you use?
Maven and Gradle. Okay. And there are some Go projects and some Python projects, yeah. But mostly Maven.
But so there's no clear choice. Can you use Maven or
no?
It's just what the team wants.
Yeah.
For the front end stuff. Does it also use Jenkins or?
Yep. Yeah, so there are also NPM builds, but they are done in Docker. Yep, so there's also NPM.
Yeah.
So, all this information and more in depth on how it actually works with the job that is all explained in details, actual coding in there. You can see it in the presentation, and the links will be shared later on. But while we implemented this, users wanted more. They wanted more freedom, more autonomy. and smaller, and with Man on the Moon they were allocated to smaller releases and at least more often. But but they were not completely ready for it. They did some baby steps, but they fall down. So that's why we created Mayfly, which basically was is a continuous delivery platform where we, based on their Jira workflow, we applied the best practices from continuous delivery. So feature branches, and an isolated test environment for your feature branch, and definitional DOM checks to check if the feature was ready to go to production, and when it automatically could go to production. And now, sorry, they go on how it works. So, this is our test application. Our fancy animal. There are no quotes in here, but in the feature branch it is. So, you go to Jira, you can just create a ticket. You give the nice name, and you select an application that it's bound to. So you bound your Jira ticket to an application. In this case it's DBTest. DBT. And then create the ticket. And on this from here on, nothing is still happening on Mayfly. So yeah, I can show you that. So you get a definitive DOM check, which is all unknown at the moment. So it does test on checks for unit tests, service tests, pull requests accepted. Is the environment live, yes or no? And then when you, so there's also no branch created. So nothing is done when you create a ticket. But when you move it to in progress, it will start creating a branch for your feature. It will start an environment. It will create the needed resources. So, create a branch, create the Jenkins jobs, create the configuration management. Jenkins jobs. This is all based on the Jenkins job data. And the configuration for that is in the repository of the team application. So we fetch, get that configuration and apply it. So they know, the users don't need any merge requests anymore. It's just JSON application and it works. And then we have to wait a while, because sometimes it takes a while to start an environment. But bit by bit, so it started the box queue, there's a message queue, Postgres database, logging was in there. And while it's starting, it also created the branch. Let's just start editing. So in the background it will still start at the environment. Oh, there's an Oracle database. Yes, we start an Oracle database in Docker. And yeah, that's why the Oracle database takes a long time, because it's about 13 gigabytes of Docker image. Yeah, there are passwords in there, but yeah. they are generated temporary passwords, only for your feature branch. So we edit the text. So this is the whole application. This index format. It's not that bad. But just to indicate that so when the environment is started, the environment is based on what was running on production at that moment. And after we pushed it, this code, and it has been built, and the Docker image has been pushed to the registry, the feature branch, the feature environment will be updated with your changes. So you always have the production version plus your changes, nothing else. So let's see. Should we start it now? Yes, the environment was started. So this was the... Almost.
You can stop it.
Yeah, I know. So it was started. And here you see a quote. So every, so from the message queue in the database, it actually fetches some data. Yeah. So we already pushed the code, and Jenkins is starting building. Yeah. So now the build is just a Gradle build, doing some small unit test and creating a Docker image and pushing that to the registry. And at the end, it will trigger, it will notify Mayfly from, hey, I have created the Docker image, and this is the, so here in this Groovy script, it's saying this commit has now a Docker container. So all the Docker containers are tagged with the commit hash that has from the code. And now Jenkins is archiving the workspace, so we can reuse the workspace somewhere else. But it's already triggered Mayfly, and then in the background Mayfly is already starting to deploy the new container. And you can make this. You have the full control of the job data, so you can create any jobs that you want here. As long as the first one is called build, it's fine. Yeah, so it's archived. And it triggered another job to publish some reports. So the test reports are also sent to Mayfly, so we can use the test report results for the definition tone check.
I just think we have like a Mayfly plugin in Jenkins or something for, so that you can trigger these updates
when
your job is selling.
No, it's just calling a Groovy script.
Yeah.
Yeah. It has some work there.
Actually, you can also do a shared library or something.
Yeah, but then you also have to fetch the artifact somewhere, and that's not that. Not the at grabs in Groovy, they are not always working.
Yeah.
So, for now, we choose to. We just have a template and a documentation page saying, hey, copy this, and then it works.
Yeah.
And then they can start changing from that. It's one Groovy call in HTTP call in Groovy.
Mm-hmm.
So, it was deployed. And everything was green, yes. And the only thing that was left was the pull request. So in Stash, we're using Stash as Git manager here. You have the opportunity to approve a pull request. So when you approve it, the definition DOM will check. Yes, someone approved it. So everything is green. And basically, the story is now ready for production. But to show you that, if you unapprove, you remove the remove, the definition of DOM is failed again, and we cannot resolve the story then. So there's actually a check, is the definition of DOM all green or not? Yes, you cannot finish it. Yep. So we created a Jar plugin for this, which talks to Mayfly on below the surface. So, when everything is green, we can mark, so we can actually resolve the story. And then the Docker container that was created for the feature branch is re-tagged to be for production. So, just tagged with a different tag, I don't know, the extra version, but a different tag. And then deployed to the production environment. And everything, all the other resources that were started during feature. For the feature environment is closed off. So everything at the end of your story, there are no resources left besides the production. And that takes also a while to load. And that means that your feature branch is merged to master. And when other feature branches are open, we will push, we create a pull request from the master to that feature branch. And if possible, if there are no conflicts, we will auto-merge the master into your feature branch. So your feature branch is always up to date with master, unless you tell Mayfly not to merge it automatically for you. Yeah, that's basically Mayfly. And with this, it was another step for educating the developers to continuously think and get used to feature branches. So with this, because every branch has its own Jenkins jobs, its own isolated environment, you can, if one team breaks its feature branch, no one else is impacted. And that was the major, the major feature of Mayfly. At least you could do it with feature branches yourself, of course, but this would take the developers by hand. Please do it this way.
When you say it starts an environment which is effectively based off of production, is that only the code or does it include content?
Only the code. But for example, for the databases, what we suggested to what most developers are doing is they create we have base images for databases, and they create a layer on top of that which has test data. So then it's pre-filled. But you can also just from your test, pushing the data into the database or whatever, because all the data that you saw in the assets, the passwords, everything, it's available to your code. In your Jenkins job, it's all available, so you can use it.
Do you also have guidelines on the how long such a feature branch can live?
No. No, there are no guidelines, and we don't push anything besides the flow at this moment. But and we don't do that because if they keep it open for a long time, they will feel the pain anyway.
Yeah, so,
and because there are pull requests open from the master with all the changes from master into your branch, and which if there are no conflicts, it will auto merge. The pain is already limited as much as possible. Mm.
But we also clean up the thing, because if someone starts a branch a year ago and then suddenly it doesn't do anything with it and doesn't close the tickets,
it's
already there.
Yep. It will just keep running. But most teams, most product owners push their teams to get actually something to production. I hope. So yeah. So the principles, feature-centered development, isolated environments, and the feature environment is production plus a feature, and when it's done, release the production. Not everyone is doing that, but the option is there. And for the users, it means almost self-service, because we as DPI still have to create an actual application to Mayfly, so almost. We use Stash as a Git repository, Jenkins with Jobia DSL for continuous integration, Jira for issue tracking, and well, there are definitely ton of checks. So, Mayfly.com, sorry, I thought I missed something. So, and there was already a team using Mayfly before we, as DPI, actually used it. So when we were still manually deploying our Mayfly service, a team was already using it. And after a month or two, we actually started developing Mayfly with Mayfly. So even now, when we create a feature and change, it's on production directly when we close the story for Mayfly. About 25% of the projects is now in Mayfly, of in development Mayfly, and there's a Mesos cluster below it to do all the container orchestration. And Martin, my teammate, he gave this presentation about how Mayfly works internally at DevOps in 2015, I believe. So you can watch that afterwards. So, with Mayfly, developers start embraced continuous delivery more and smaller releases. So they got a step further into being ready for self-service. And self-service is the next thing for us. Because with Men on the Moon, the slogan came up like, you build it, you run it, you love it. you are the owner of your application, and the team should become fully autonomous. And that's only possible when the teams can do everything themselves. So a service is owned by a team. A team can have one or more services. And where we're going to work towards is that integrations like with Artifactory and SonarQube or whatever you need to integrate with is done on the service account. So currently in our Jenkins, we as DPI have one authentication key for Artifactory, one for SonarQube, one for Rundeck. We manage the authentication to the integration where the tools where we integrate with. And in self-service, it needs to be put to the teams. But an application or a server can switch teams. So the only static point in there is that there's a service. So from that, we decided that the service should be the one who integrates with the other services, or all the external parties, all the other tools, and not the team. So with this, everything after this slide is work in progress or still in the planning to do. So we can kick the ball with the implementation. So we do continuous living with GitLab. We already used GitLab for a long time as just a simple Git repository manager. And we're now also starting to use it for continuous integration. But basically, you can do anything in GitLab that you need for your development process. And they are extending it more and more. So let me show you how that works, how the pipeline flow, like we did in Jenkins, works in GitHub. So this actually starts completely from scratch. So as a user, as a simple user, no, not admin user, we can just create a project in our own group or in a group that we created for the application. And enable the settings to have a pipeline. And from the pipeline, it enables the CI/CD part. And save. So now we have a CI/CD pipelines information, and we have some shared runners. So at the moment it's like a testing phase. So we have two runners running, which are Docker containers, and they start Docker containers to do the exit build. So let's check out their empty repository. Is everyone not a coder here? Everyone knows how to create a simple project and unit test and stuff.
Because then I will continue to
So we push the code. But there's no continuous integration yet, no pipelines, no nothing. And then we set up a CI, from which you can select templates. This is just all default GitLab functionality. You can't apply a template. We select Gradle because it's a Gradle project. We change the image to something that's available inside the network. And this is the container. The Docker image that's used for doing the build. So the GitLab CI does everything in Docker containers, and you define what container it uses, so what in Docker image is used to do the build in. Which means that we as DPI don't have to take care of even installing JDK upgrades or whatever tool that you want to use. And that's it. You apply the file. You get a pipeline, you get a build, and it's a very simple build, so 7 seconds. And after it, it will run the next job in the pipeline. So with this, all Jenkins all the functionality in Jenkins is now self-service, at least from the build side. And so this is a very simple pipeline. So build and then test. You can make this extensor as extensive as you want. You can even trigger pipelines with other pipelines. You can make pipelines between different projects. It all works. You get some graphs in there. And it's still the early stage for GitLab CI. And you notice that every release, so GitLab does a release always on the 21st of the month. They do a new release. No matter what's in there, they do a new release. You just see the UI growing, the usability features. But the pipeline is just a simple YAML file. You say, hey, this are my build stages, do this in my build stage, allow failing, yes or no. And so for now, we add an additional test stage. It does exactly the same. You save it, and your pipeline is updated with the new stage, new step. So now we have one build, we trigger two tests. And in the end, you can combine them together again.
So this replaces Jenkins?
Yeah. Currently not, but in the end, that's where we're working towards, yeah.
And your job is basically a copy of the template?
Who's job? The developer's job or my job?
The build job.
Oh, the build job, yeah. So the Jenkins job DSL or the pipeline DSL is exactly the same as this pipeline.
Do you help the developers in setting up a sensible template here? So that if they select Gradle, that they actually get one person or something? Or is it
That's not possible yet in the effect. So, yeah. So there's no way to customize the templates yet, but it will come there, and otherwise it will just be copy-paste from documentation somewhere,
and then
probably.
Docker images for doing the builds in, is that something that the development teams are responsible for as well, or do you have some sensible default?
Yeah, so we as DPI will provide some sensible defaults, default containers, and then the rest is to the community. If we see that the container, some other container is used a lot, then we can just take it over and they manage that. It's like we just give them a push in the right direction, and the rest should be done by the community.
Yeah. Is this a cloud instance or a local instance of GitLab?
This is local.
Okay.
Yeah. I will show you the details.
Is GitLab mature enough to replace Jenkins at all, or?
Yeah. There are a lot of projects already running there. They maintain GitLab Cloud, and it runs the same build. So, and basically all the CI systems in the cloud use the same principle. Mm-hmm. It's really one simple agent is running in a Docker container. It's one simple Go application which asks the GitLab application, do we have some work for me? Yes, and it does its work. Start some Docker containers, and that's it.
But I noticed that it can be quite slow to get that runners. It actually starts.
It depends.
It depends on
the
configuration.
Yeah, it depends. So we use Docker containers, and the images that we used so far, they're already cached because they're used more often. So they start very quickly. But other users they use VM virtual machines, which is also possible. Then you have to wait for the start of the VM. And in the end, of course, you always have to do some caching because it's a clean Docker container. So even the Maven repository is not cached on that container. So GitLab has support to cache the cache files, and then for when the container starts, it will load in the quick cache. So you can pre-fill the Maven cache for your application.
There are other pipelines in the cloud, a Bitbucket or whatever, that you assume you did an evaluation of the different options?
No. I think I'm a big fan of GitLab for a long time. I have looked in the past about on all the continuous delivery tools. Mm. So I did an evaluation a few years ago. And when we started with this, no one else just maybe made it. So the only one who has really nice pipelines is go.cd. Mm-hmm. But if you start it, it feels like Jenkins. combined with cruise control from 15 years ago, because the code from cruise control was still in there. Yeah, they created a fancy product, but the base is still very old.
And at the same time, you say a few years ago,
yeah.
that's the ancient history that we're talking about. So, yeah, a few years later. So.
If you have seen anything fancier than this, that's hosted on your own premise, please tell me, because I've not seen it.
No, okay, that's fair enough. So.
Okay. Yeah. You also talk about Concourse.
Concourse.
Yeah.
Yeah. It also has fancy pipelines. They used it. I've talked to that actually use it.
Yeah.
The first thing that they say is that the pipelines are so difficult that a normal developer will not be able to configure, because everything is a resource. The principle. So for those who don't know Concourse is the only thing that Concourse does is building or executing something, and you define your pipeline in resources, and the resource has an input, an output, and something to be done. That's it. So that sounds really simple. But all those resources are plugins in Concourse. And when I have a bad feeling about plugins, whenever I heard the word plugins, because no one implements it nice. So plugins. And you can make anything from that, but even the simplest configurations are already a large file, as far as I've seen by those who use it in production. So that's why I discarded it pretty really quickly. Yeah.
Can you use Mayfly and GitLab together? So instead of creating a branching stash and the job in Jenkins, you can create both.
We're actually implementing that next week.
Oh.
Not just because you asked, but we had some downtime. So downtime in the sense we had not really something to do. So we decided, hey, we already decided to phase out stacks. So just as an indication, just let's see if we can let Mayfly talk to GitLab, and that works nicely in the end, because even the least. We haven't tested this yet. I'm sure that will work nicely. Because the only reason why we started with Stash was that GitLab at that time didn't have an option to approve a pull request. That's really the only thing, and we couldn't. Yeah, we just wanted to get started, and Stash was really not expensive for, and because we already have the Jira and the conference and everything, so we get it basically for free. So we just started with it.
2 years ago, it was a very sensible option.
Yeah, so, and now we're facing it out.
Yeah. What would you suggest to companies looking at Jenkins, GitLab? Would you invest now more in GitLab or in Jenkins, for example?
Yeah, I will say go with GitLab, because you get basically everything for free. And every month you have some new features which you don't have to do anything for. It's enabled, it just works.
And that's already more than Jenkins offers.
Yeah. Well, then, okay. So back to the plugins.
Yeah.
The reason why I hate plugins is that a plugin is first has a version. But I have not seen any tool yet that managed the compatibility between version of the plugin and the version of the tool. And we now do only this year, I think, they started with it a little bit in Jenkins, which is basically a JavaScript call. So they started in the UI to show you, hey, if you upgrade this version of the plugin, you need to go upgrade to a new version of Jenkins. But it's really hacky.
And then you have to,
it's not in the package management.
Yeah.
So that's why I say don't use plugins. And if you look at the plugins in Jenkins, what are they actually doing? So in our Jenkins instance, we have about 150 Jenkins plugins, and most of them are just show a JUnit report. So I could just print the just give the user, hey, here's your JUnit index.html.
Yeah.
Watch it in your browser. Why does Jenkins need to show it for me? And the plugins that actually talk to another tool, they just on the command line, they just execute some command line shell, but then they limit you to the commands that they have implemented. So why not just run a shell script to say to actually call that command line and do whatever is possible with that command line too. Right?
Yeah.
So and that's with GitLab. You can just it's in your repository with GitLab. So you can just create a shell script or Groovy or whatever language you want to support in your build scripting and and run it. So I would really suggest just go for GitLab and don't start implementing something yourself, because GitLab has a lot of resources to get actually something implemented.
It might be worthwhile mentioning that there should be multiple options. We started out with Jenkins, went to Drone, and then to GitLab. And Drone is a really nice option if you don't want the entire repository management system tied into your CI pipeline. Only want a job running build system that integrates with other tools.
Yeah.
We've been using this setup for more than a year, and we really recommend it. But Drone is a really nice alternative that works on the same principles.
Yeah. So that's the only thing I find it kind of scary with GitLab is that they want to. Last year they decided to basically create a complete developer integrated environment in GitLab. So they want to do anything.
Awesome.
Yeah, it sounds awesome. It is awesome if it all works, but if they are doing, well, if they break it, or if they go a different direction, then it's in your GitLab. So, but
they accidentally delete the database.
Yeah. So far, the upgrade of GitLab was really, they have an excellent upgrade for policy and process. It's just, I install the new RPM and it works. They take care of everything. And most of the things that take longer, they will run it in the background. So the product itself is awesome, but if they go into a different direction, then yeah, you're not stuck with it, but there's nothing else that's good enough or better than GitLab, in my opinion. So, but you're kind of, you're not stuck with it. It's there.
You can always fork it and make your own.
You can do that.
Yeah.
But for now, it's awesome.
So let's go to the next.
So fully self-service, continuous integration, issue tracking, wiki hosting, pages, it's all in there. So GitLab, we currently have 100 gigabytes of proposed storage, and of the 700 repositories. There are 1,300 forks, so they're pretty busy. So and everything is high available and tool runners for the actual builds. But so as I said, it's just an experimental stage at this moment. But we're ready to extend.
All this infra you're showing, is this on-premise Bolt and Kong infra?
Yeah. So we have our own data centers and it's all 13 machines and some bare metals.
Not
at the moment.
Is there a reason why?
I don't know. They started migrating to their own data center 4 years ago or something.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, it works nice.
Once you all invest in your own data center, then you have this drawback that you already made the investment.
Yeah,
when you have nothing, cloud is great, but you know, when you have it, then
it's
a very, very small driver.
So what about deployment?
Yes.
So this thing, we're looking at Spinnaker, and they say continuous delivery enterprise, which is just continuous deployment. The whole website says deployment. Continuous deployment. And it basically talks to Kubernetes most of the time, or any cloud provider. And we're experimenting this with Kubernetes at the moment. So, I didn't have a demo myself, so I picked 1 minute for my tutorial. But at least it gives you an indication on how it works or how it looks like.
The app is a simple Hello World app written in Go. Currently, it displays Hello GCP in all environments. The developer makes a change and initiates a release by promoting code to the release branch in GitHub. Google Container Registry build starts a container build. The new container is built and stored in Google Container Registry, tagged with a triggering commit hash. A Spinnaker pipeline is triggered to pull the new image and deploy it out to a staging Kubernetes environment using blue-green deployment strategy. At the completion of the staging pipeline, a validation pipeline is triggered to confirm that what's in staging looks good for promotion to production. We check our app in staging and confirm whether the new message looks good. It looks good, so we click continue. A promotion pipeline kicks off to deploy the change to our production Kubernetes environment. It picks up the image that was deployed to and confirmed in stage and deploys it to prod using the blue-green deployment strategy. The old replica set still exists, though it is not taking any traffic. We want to keep it around just in case post-deploy smoke tests fail. We run a simple smoke test against the new replica set, wait 30 minutes for good measure, before scaling down the old replica set to free up resources. We keep the old scale down replica set around for another 2 hours to allow for a quick rollback. And after manual confirmation, we destroy the old replica set. We have successfully completed a safe deploy to prod.
That's basically it. That's you, right? Sorry?
Does it work like that for real?
For you. Yeah, we experimented with it. Yeah, it works. What we do is, so we do the builds in GitHub,
yeah.
And then we build Docker containers, push to registry, and then the pipeline from Spinnaker looks at the registry and triggers on that. And from there we deploy to an environment. And
yeah,
at the moment we only tried it with two environments. But yeah, the idea is that the pipelines are completely configured by the users, and they have created this UI, but this UI is just talking to the API. So everything is API based first, and then they create an API and a UI for it.
But what is the blue green deployments?
Yeah, blue green. So what you saw, it has one environment running, and it will deploy your new environment next to it, and then when that's fully up and running and smoke tested, they turn off the old environment. And keep it, or at least not turn it off, but remove traffic. And then when everything looks fine for another period, an hour or so, that it thought through,
yeah.
Then it will delete the old environment. And they can also do that rolling, so if you have a lot of machines, then it will one by one turn it off. Mm-hmm. And canary testing. So the cool part of this is that they provide the most sensible deployment strategies and configurations that most of the teams use. Well, it's Netflix, so they do all the fancy stuff. And it's in there, and you can just use it. And just with GitLab, they provide it, and there's no plugin. it's just there, it works, and that's it.
So the main reason you're using Spinnaker for deployments instead of GitLab is mostly because of same defaults.
Yeah. Yeah, and in GitLab, in your pipeline in GitLab, you can also define deployments, which is basically executing a shell script, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So from that shell script, you could trigger Spinnaker, or you can just do it based on the Docker registry, like we did. And a colleague of mine is currently working on the GitLab integration with Spinnaker, so that will also be open source, and then. Because it's included in Spinnaker directly. So, soon there will be integration for GitHub. So the features, fully self-service, integration with some CI integrations with Jenkins and Travis CI, standard deployment strategies, manual adjustments, you can approve something, and enough authentication to define who may do something, may do what. So we're running a team in Kubernetes, deploying to Kubernetes, and focus on containers. Artifacts? We use artifacting for your artifacts. Who doesn't know artifacting? Nexus. Artifacting, it's artifact management. Put some. It's like a big file store. That's it. With a nice API. And it works if you're running the artifact yourself, as like we do as DPI. But there's currently no way in artifact for users to manage their own dependencies or their own part of artifact. So what we want is actually we want Bintray, which is the cloud service of artifact, and then without the costs, because $1 per gigabyte of storage. I can tell you we have 10 terabytes of artifacts. We're not going to pay $10,000 for our artifacts. And they don't even tell if it's per month, per year, or whatever. Well, and 45 cents per gigabyte download, if we download a webshop, we're 1 gigabyte further. So, and I don't know how many production servers we have for the webshop, but that will be a lot. So that's all doable. But basically what we want in that Artifactory is users should be able to manage their own service account and claim package namespace, because what you don't have on the internet is there's no... You can put anything in Bintray or Maven Central without anyone checking if that namespace is already used. But we don't want that, at least not internally. Because why would you... if you give everyone to the permission to maintain their own service account and put anything in there that they want, because we're not going to do any checking on that, they can also override someone else's artifacts by just putting the same namespace and a different version of the artifact, or the same version and then the one that comes first will be picked. So, yeah, we want a way to claim a namespace. And of course, the most asked question that we get for Artifactory is, hey, this something is on the internet and we don't have access to it. Can you please proxy it in Artifactory? Like most of the NPM binaries that are not in NPM registry, for those who have ever used NPM. So in NPM, there's an NPM registry which also has all the NPM packages. But some of the NPM packages, the node packages, they actually need the binaries for your specific OS, and it fetches it directly from GitHub.
Yeah.
So, what's the use of the NPM package registry? So, they should be able to add that themselves, but they still need to be approved by someone, in our case, security. In the sense like, do we trust this?
Yeah.
Do you trust the internet? No. But this part I do trust for this moment. Yeah, that's the only thing we can say on the internet, right? So that's what we are...
Can you check some made by the security?
No, because it doesn't exist. So this is what we want. And this is what we hopefully Artifactory will provide it, but I don't think so, because they have their own Bintray and it makes more money. We're going there. So we probably will create it ourselves, because Artifactory is not open source, even though they say it's the free version is Artifactory open source. It's not open source, it's for open source. The code is nowhere to be found. So we will create something against it, and hopefully Artifactory will be able to pick it up someday. The idea is that we open source it, but yeah, there's no code yet. I cannot promise anything.
And the Nexus is even worse?
It's the same. If you look, I haven't looked at the Nexus in the past 2 years or so, but JFrog was always far before, further innovated than Nexus.
Sorry.
Yeah, sorry.
More to know about Nexus?
If it has self-service in there for users.
Yeah, but depending what you mean by self-service. So claiming
this. I mean self-service.
Yeah.
Is that in Nexus?
No.
And there are only three artifactory management types, right? Archiva from Apache, which is like very old school, I believe. Nexus.
It's open source.
It's open source. Maybe we have to look at this.
At least you have a starting point.
That's true. Yeah. Nexus and Artifacti.
You also buy it.
Yeah.
So
our Artifacti, we have about 10.2 terabytes of artifacts. And 10.1 are deployables that actually have been on production or are ready to go to production. We use Maven, MPN, Bower, PFI, and sadly the app instances are not high available. Because then you have to, like if you have the pro license, it costs $3,000 per year. If you want high available, pay 30,000. Yeah. So we just created a shell script, which a watch script looks at the instances, and if one goes down, the other one starts.
So what do you use for Docker registry? Parody of Artifactory?
No, not Artifactory. What was it? There was one from Docker, the not the paid one, but the open source Docker registry.
Yeah,
basic
Docker registry.
Yeah.
Hey, I hope this is create a lot of artifacts for them in your whole story.
Yep.
And actually, only the most recent one, and maybe the one before that, though, and the other hundreds or so. Do you clean them up?
At the moment, no.
Yeah, because in the base version, there's also a cleanup function, I guess.
Probably. We do use the base version, the pro version.
Yeah.
But not the one of the most expensive ones. But, I have not confirmed it somewhere, but I've heard that we have to keep the artifacts for 7 years. So.
And it's probably from storage that's much cheaper than $1 per gigabyte.
Yeah. The only problem with the artifact is that there's no way to say this is the newest artifacts, put it on quick storage, and this is the older artifacts, put it on slower storage.
Yeah.
There's no way.
And the same thing with all the dependencies that you've cached.
Yeah.
You want to keep a dependency as long as it's relevant, but if you're never going to build something anymore, But you don't know.
Well, you do know that there's artifactory counts all the uses of an artifact.
Yeah.
So you can use the count and the latest used.
Yeah.
But for production artifacts, there might be applications on production that have not been touched for 2 years.
Yeah, so maybe you do need it, except you haven't used it.
Yeah.
So there's no...
Exactly. So maybe you have to see what version is running on production, what is an artifact.
Yeah.
But we don't have it yet.
Do you use any type of scanning on the Docker images that you build with stuff like Claire or?
No. For Docker images we don't have anything yet. Yeah, we created an internal build tool called Bob the Builder, and the only thing that it does is check your Docker image if it's from a whitelisted base image. That's the only thing that it does at the moment. The idea in the beginning was that it actually was going to do Docker scanning, but we didn't get to that.
So
we'll probably phase it out someday.
There are tools for that, I'm not an expert.
Exactly, there are tools for that.
Yes, solutions.
So for code quality, we use SonarQube. It's a tool for displaying sonar code quality. Good one. If you're going to use this, it doesn't do anything out of yourself. You have to run time curves and all the checks yourself. And from that report, it creates a nice dashboard. It doesn't do anything. Don't expect a project that you just add SonarQube and imagine he has a report. Yeah, maybe the code, the lines of code, but that's it.
So you use Maven plugins or something to run checks and post it to SonarQube stuff?
Yeah.
Scan it. You build it in your pipeline.
Sorry?
You build it into your pipeline.
Yeah,
and your build course
build tool itself. So where you switch from Jenkins to GitLab, for example, is not going to influence Discord.
No.
Because it's in, it can become Gradle or Maven.
Yeah, and if you do it in your build tool like Maven and Gradle,
yeah.
The solar checks can also be done locally.
Locally, yeah. More problems.
So what we would expect in self-service from SonarQube is, I want a service account. I want to do anything that's possible in Sonar, like dashboards, quality rules, gates, profiles. It's my code, so I have to decide what my rules are that I want to apply on my project. And luckily, SonarQube is building Sonar Cloud, so they should be able to.
It's available.
It's already available, so it should be self-service. We just have to see if it comes in the next version of the next LTS version of SonarQube, available to hosted version somewhere. And we want to use SonarLint. So SonarLint is a plugin for IntelliJ or Eclipse, or you can run it from the command line, which talks to your Sonar instance and gets all the rules for your project and basically code inspections locally. So directly in IntelliJ you can see, hey, this Sonar rule triggered here. So you can work away all the failures in your in Sonar checks before you push it to the post. So should be fully self-service. Hopefully it will be in SonarQube 6 because that's what they're running in Sonar Cloud. And otherwise we will implement it in SonarQube because it's open source. Or you will write it themselves if they don't accept it. And we run it since 2015. About 200 projects are in there. For the 400 something we have. So not everyone is using it, but it's their decision. and it's, yeah, not, we have one instance for that.
But quality is not mandatory in
core.com. it's your decision.
Yeah.
But that's the whole philosophy, basically in all development. It's your application.
You build it to run it.
You
feel the pain.
Exactly. If you don't want to create unit tests, fine. But then someday you will probably walk around having more bugs than the rest of the company. So it's your code, not mine.
Do you report on that? Who is using to help you?
Nope.
Or do you keep an eye on that?
It's their decision. I don't care. I care for better quality. So
you need to come teach or help team to do that. So
yeah.
If the team that's not doing it, you can tell hey.
Exactly. So okay, then the next step is plus build support. So next step, when everything is self-service, we as DPI have less to do. So we can actually focus on the users by providing build support. And in some way, we have been doing this for years in HipChat, our chat client. We have multiple support channels. And as said, we have one engineer of duty every sprint. And that engineer of duty is in the subject of every support channel. So everyone who has an issue with anything from DPI goes to the one of the channels that fits your topic. Talk to the one who's mentioned in the AOD that's mentioned in the subject room. And he will help you fix the issue. And at the moment, it can be just, hey, my Jenkins job fails. And then we explain them, we try to educate them in how to fix it and how they can resolve the issues next time themselves. And sometimes we have to look at what went wrong below the surface in JDK or whatever. So, because it's an all shared environment in Jenkins.
So for you, it's the same. You build it, you run it.
Yeah. Yeah. But we only run third party software. So, this worked great, by the way. Even in the support channels, more and more developers are using, are helping themselves. So, we have one guy, engineer on duty, who is there. The idea is to be there full time, but of course we also go for coffee and breaks and lunch and stuff. And when no one reacts, then most of the time one of the other developers helps out. So they will educate themselves also. And these days, most of the time is just merging, accepting merge requests for the TuxP configuration. That's most of the time the only thing that the engineer has to do. So bit by bit, you educate them going forward. And next step, when we get more time, because everything is self-service, we actually want to go out to the teams to help them improve their builds. Like you said, when we can, from the statistics that we have in the builds, we can see, hey, you're not using this, or your build is taking 1 hour, why it's taking 1 hour? Then we can go to them and help them fix them and improve their build process. And because we're done, if you're going out as consultants within the company, we see what is used and what's not used, and how stuff is used in their build automation. We can apply best practices or we can provide build best practices plugins for providing the most common use cases as defaults, and just make it simple.
We have a few competition from SaaS-based dev tools.
Sorry, what do we have?
Well, and say if I'm a developer,
yeah,
and my laptop is connected to the internet, I can choose whatever tool on the internet there is.
Yeah.
Maybe it's forbidden.
AWS pipeline or
yeah. I don't know if you already go out to Teams or if you have had cases where developers figured like, well, SonarQube is nice, but I have a better tool.
Yeah, so if you have the better tool, yeah, then you have to proof of concept it themselves.
Yeah.
Basically, they have to get time for it from the product owner,
yeah,
and try it out. And if they get enough support from them from other teams,
yeah,
then we as DPI can say, hey, it's interesting enough for the teams, so let's see if we can incorporate it in our services.
The form of a shadow CI/CD, like if you have to.
So we had a team. The guy was one of the guys in the team was completely saying, I want to manage anything in Jenkins myself.
Yeah.
So he got an environment virtual machine, installed Jenkins, and did all the builds before it went to our Jenkins build.
Uh-huh.
And yeah, that's fine by me if they get the time for it.
Yeah.
I don't care. It's not something that I need to manage, right?
Yeah. And if they want to use GitHub and the pipelines over there,
but then the same thing counts. They have to talk to security because then they have to go outside.
Yeah.
Or pay $1.5 million for the hosted version. Yeah, if they get the money for it, fine.
Yeah.
When is your team doing, how is your team being evaluated at the end of the year?
End of the year?
Continuously, I don't care.
Yeah, I don't know.
Because of course, this team started for a reason, but
yeah,
at some point you might say, yeah.
Yeah, so in the beginning, in 2012 it really was setting everything up, and
yeah,
bit by bit educating. And now when it becomes more self-service, there's less to do for us.
Yeah.
And that's the whole idea for our team. We're automating ourselves away.
Yeah.
So the work that we can do, that we now do with 6 people, should be able to be done by 2 people in the next year. And then the other 4 people can do other stuff,
uh-huh,
like build consultancy.
Yeah, so within your team you also look for new
challenges
and purposes.
Yeah.
Continuously.
Yeah. Okay. So at the beginning of this year we had about 25 different services that we had to manage,
mm-hmm,
including the 9 services from Mayfly, because Mayfly itself exists of 9 services itself.
Okay.
And so Jenkins, Git, GitLab, Stash, and Jira Conference is also part of our OPEX. And we had to manage that all, including upgrades, plugins upgrades, and everything. And that takes time.
Mm-hmm.
And if you have a lot of services to do, there's less to innovate, because you have to choose what are we going to do. So if we had a period where we split up the team in 3 sub-teams,
mm-hmm,
and we had one for the build automation, one for Mayfly, and one for the test automation, and there were 2 people, and they did the engineering duty themselves, and they rotated between the different teams every sprint. So every sprint you will move from build to Mayfly, from Mayfly to test. So you would still have the knowledge of everything, but yeah. And by that we had it really helped us by getting stuff forward in those different lanes. Because if you have one lane where everything is needs to be done, there's no focus. You have to switch all the time from tool to tool. And this really helped us by focusing. And now we're bit by bit limiting the amount of services that we actually provide by removing steps first. Going to look at and just merging stuff together so we have more time to actually do something. So build support?
Yeah,
that's it. So an overview of what we did in the how the story went and goes. So in the beginning we had release cycles of 4 to 8 weeks and the whole company was one go. So every 4 or 8 weeks the whole company, all the services were turned off and then upgraded and then started again. And I don't know, but I've heard it took 2 or 3 hours in the morning.
So no shop at that time?
Yep. And that has been till somewhere here in 2014. So only since 2014 we started the independent releases. Yeah. You have to come from somewhere, right?
Yeah, that's exactly.
And now in the end it's all focused completely self-service.
So resources,
that's it. Everything is managed in Puppet, and the secrets are there, completely encrypted in there. So we as users, we have no clue what the actual values are. That's it.
What's
yeah.
The encryption key?
Puppet.
Yeah. Where are you moving to, like, vault type stuff?
So when we're, I don't know. But what we are, for example, with the GitHub, to the authentication to Artifactory and so on and in GitHub you have secret keys, you can just paste them in there. So every team knows about the secrets then, to integrate with the environment, but it's secret for anyone else. Yeah, and how it's going to work in when we do full container deployment in Spinnaker, I don't know. That's the secret. Yeah.
You also showed that you are using the messages with Marathon during the in CI pipelines, but you're experimenting now with the Spinnaker and Kubernetes.
Yeah.
Are you also playing face out the messages?
So Mesos is currently only used for Mayfly.
Okay.
And that's because there was nothing in it for container deployments and we just started. So in there was in the beginning in 2014, there was the containers was just coming up,
mm-hmm.
And in 1 week we switched 3 or 4 tools, and in the end we just came back to Mesos. So it's the most production ready.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we're still using it. It works.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you won't touch that until it breaks.
Sorry.
You will not be changing that until it breaks. So.
Yeah, until we turn Mayfly in, because that's also with GitLab. All the features that we wanted in Mayfly are in GitLab. The isolated environment is in GitLab. We don't have to create it ourselves. So if we're completely over, we can turn off almost anything, everything with Mayfly. Because the only thing that we were missing in GitLab is the definition of DOM check. And well, we could make that a separate service and just be used by via webhook in GitLab. And merging map to master, that's a feature of the enterprise edition of GitLab. So basically, we leave one surface of Mayfly and we still have all the features.
Are your systems the only way to get to production to prevent people using other tools to push to production?
I actually don't know. Because there may be other services, and if they just ask the infrastructure guys, hey, can I have access to RunMac?
Mm-hmm.
then we run like a shower deployment tool at the moment, and then they can access deployment.
So yeah.
Okay. Yeah. But as far as I know, Artifactory is the base for everything at the moment. Yeah.
What do you use for secure code analysis? Would you use or do you not rely on plugins from Sonar?
Security checks. There's a plugin in Sonar for security checks. But yeah, it depends on whatever tool you're running locally. And as I said, we don't enforce anything. So if a team comes up with it and wants to use it, fine. Yeah. And we might, we have ideas on how it will, how security would work without impacting the build. But that's a whole story in itself. And if my product owner starts with it, they are not here, not done within an hour. So I hope him to get him there talking in the next meetup someday. So yes, has really nice ideas on how that should work, because we don't want to enforce anything on the developers. So everything should be checked on the outside, like in Artifactory or even on production. So.
And to elaborate a bit on that, we also recommend teams to use OWASP checks or other security checks in their build pipeline.
Yeah, if they want to use it. It's very common, of course, but it's their choice.
But do you also make plugins for that to make it easier to integrate?
Not at the moment, not. But when we get to build support, that kinds of things will hopefully get them done. Anything else? Good. Okay. Thank you.